Thank you all for taking time off. You know, the later half of the day is already 4:30. I will try to be kind of brief. And a special thanks to Professor Sandeep Shastri for inviting me and to all the organizers who have kind of helped. Dr. Roli has been of great help. And I generally find it easier because, you know, on the Zoom, when you have to present, you have to transfer the presentation from one to other. And invariably, it doesn't go through in one go. So, you know, you waste about 2-3 minutes, but those two, 3 minutes are very irritating. So I generally find just as we have our hands off. So it's much easier to say the next slide, please, and the next slide comes. So that is what I do it this way. And thank you, Apurva, for doing that. And thanks, Nilesh, for a warm introduction. And, you know, Bhopal is very dear to me. See, we the old timers, we still consider that as a Bhojapalita Nagari iti Bhopal, right? Goes back to Bhojraj. And of course, about 20, 30 years back, I used to regularly visit for two. One is, of course, unfortunately, there was a very good plant. Unfortunately, went through a bad accident, Union Carbide. The head happened to be one PhD from IIT Kanpur. And then, of course, a factory that is very dear to me called BHEL. Okay. And my first impression of Bhopal was when you drive around, everywhere you see more space. It's your water body and more space. So nicely kind of, I think you carry that in your new name of the university, Lake City. And as a Kanpuria, as a UP wala for about 20 years, I used to read Dainik Jagran every day. Mera Hindi thoda sa accha hai. So jitna bhi, jahan bhi mauka mile, Hindi mein baat bhi karta hoon, likhta bhi hoon. मैंने दो तीन छोटे छोटा कॉलम भी लिखा है दैनिक जागरण का. सो आई रियलाइज दैट यू आर एक्चुअली एक्चुअली दैनिक जागरण एसोसिएशन. सो आई फील वेरी गुड टू बी विथ JLU. ओके, व्हाट आई विल डू टुडे इज वेरी सिंपल, दैट इट इज नॉट रियली अ टॉक ऑन साइंस एंड टेक्नोलॉजी, इट इज नॉट एनी डीप सब्जेक्ट एनीथिंग, बट आई थॉट दैट मे बी इट विल बी अ लिटिल बिट ऑफ अ रैम्बलिंग, सो पुट अप विथ मी. ओके, द इंटेंशन इज not to ramble, okay, but it is important quite often. See, what is the advantage you get as you kind of look back into 40 plus years of teaching as a career? What is that has actually happened? I normally tell my students, you see, typically most of the undergraduate programs around the world are a 4 years duration. So we actually pretend to teach them for 4 years, in fact even charge a fee for that. But when they graduate on the day of the convocation, there is an unwritten agreement. They will teach us for next to 40 years. We teach them for 4 years for a fee, and they actually teach us for 40 years without we having to pay a fee. I think what a glorious profession we are in. Okay. So that is what I'm actually going to talk about. I had put a series of stories. Okay. Many of the stories are commonsensical stories only, but my own personal feeling is, as they said, you know, common sense is the most uncommon sense. Normal observations are the ones which are quite deep, and they did make impressions on me as an individual, me as an evolving individual. You will find that as we evolve, as we move from one institute to other institute, and you know, the later half of your career, you have more of alumni talking to you than students, because alumni are much larger number. So some students, some alumni, what they kind of taught me. Okay, this is interesting. You know, just as I am talking of the second week after I handed over charge, just looking back, I was looking at the first week of my teaching career. I had just joined as an assistant professor at IIT Kanpur. And you know, IIT Kanpur, okay, jokingly we say that we go out of IIT Kanpur only to catch a train for a railway station, or to railway station to catch a train, or those days airport used to exist, airport to catch a flight. Otherwise, we had hardly any contact with the city. So a lot of time people don't even visit the city, but I thought that, you know, it must be interesting that we should actually visit the city where I'm going to live. One from Tamil speaking fellow, one Telugu speaking fellow. They offered to assist me in exploring the city. So we got on to a Tempo. So those of you, I think Bhopal also has Tempo, right? It's a very unusual vehicle, particularly from southern part of India. We normally are not used to it. So you find that it has phenomenal carrying capacity and also very elastic, depending on their negotiation. They can put 6 people or maybe even 16 people. So anyway, it's a very interesting kind of stuff. But what is that I remember? So because we three of us, of course, you know, I was just 26 years old, so obviously much younger. So obviously had a boyish look. So the other two boys were there. We were actually talking in Tamil. And there are two elderly gentlemen who were sitting on the other side. They were kind of listening to us. Okay. Because we were talking in Tamil, the only thing they heard constantly was IIT, IIT, IIT. Right? They did not hear anything else because most other things, they did not make any meaning for them. And then they thought that we don't know Hindi because we were speaking Tamil because it was easier for us, not that we did not know Tamil. And without realizing that we followed Hindi, they kind of blurted out very nicely. Aajkal ke bachche dekho, padhte hain college mein, naam tak nahi jante. They thought that we must be studying in ITI. And instead of saying ITI, we are saying IIT. Okay. So what it means is people knew ITIs, people in Kanpur, IIT Kanpur, it was almost about 17, 18 years after IIT had started. People still do not know IIT, but they knew ITI. Okay. That is one thing, you know. So I think particularly for many of the younger institutes, they get very irritated. Even I keep telling my colleagues that you introduce yourself to somebody, they may not know your university. It takes a long time. Brand is something which is very hard. You know, even in a city like Bangalore, it is interesting. Indian Institute of Science is 108 years or 109 years old. But even at the entrance, there will be auto rickshaw fellows. If you tell them Indian Institute of Science, they would not recognize. But if you say Tata Institute, they will recognize. So that is the power of the brand. And second interesting human observation was, you know, nowadays there is so much talk about privacy and stuff like that. So this is something which is they're slowly getting used to. But actually speaking, we never felt about this, right? We were talking happily in a Tempo. I'm sure a boy and a girl are actually dating. And I'm sure maybe a mother-in-law and a daughter-in-law are fighting. All these things go on in parallel, right? That is how this country we have lived, right? So I think the fact that they overheard us, okay, I don't think it ever bothered us because that is how we are living, right? So suddenly privacy is taking a very interesting role in the Indian ethos, but this is something. And of course, the last thing for me was good learning. India is one country where anyone can have opinion about anyone, right? And these people happily thought that we are first-grade idiots, even though we all are PhDs. Doesn't matter, right? So they're entitled to their opinion. So it's interesting as to, I think, what is the human component? And I think this is typical of an Indian scenario. And I think it does teach you a lot. Okay. First and foremost, it teaches you humility. You think that you are part of a brand called IIT and right on the Deepak Thale Andhera, right on the outside of the city, they don't know you. Okay. And I think so. And second thing is we all talk in B schools about brand, the power of the brand, you know, measuring the brand, et cetera, et cetera. And, you know, I'll just, before I stop, I will tell you something, you know, we were actually helping as NGO to create some maps for the local people in Bangalore. And we were actually doing some test cases with the maid servants. And we all were surprised. All the maid servants recognize the brand of State Bank and not ICICI. So to locate the ICICI bank branch, if you put ICICI, they don't recognize. But if you put the brand with the logo of State Bank, they recognize. No, ICICI is not a small bank. And they have a great brand. That's what is taught in business schools. But on the floor, on the ground level, it is very different. So this is something which I thought I will share. So all the stories will be like this. So pardon me, and if you think that, look, it does not make sense, sorry about it, you know, old man, you have given, put me on a Vyasgadi, I will go for another 20 minutes, okay? This is something which is very interesting about pedagogy, okay? So I was quite surprised, Professor Shastri. We actually had a kind of, because Times of India had put out a news about my handing over charge, because we also did the convocation the same day. One of my IIT Kanpur alum called me from United States after 36 years. And then this is what he remembered. He said, sir, we don't remember many, many things about IIT Kanpur, but we distinctly remember you gave us a very interesting exam. So what I did was, the questions in the exams were very simple. I gave them everybody a nice answer book. I told them the time starts now. And I said, you have 60 minutes and you have to come up with six questions. Each question should be roughly about 10 minutes duration. And and they obviously must be from the portions that have been covered in the last semester. And that was the final exam. Okay. So the reason why they remembered was, it is a very different exam, right? And if you come to think about it, answering a question is much easier, but coming up with a question is much harder. So I wanted to drive home that point. And that is the reason why it possibly remained in somebody's memory after 36 years. And I think this is my request to you. It's not that you have to follow this, but I think we need as a country to do much more of innovation in teaching learning. Okay. In one hand, you know, you have all the NAC and NBA, et cetera. They have kind of put lots and lots of processes. Those processes are important, but to me, far more important is innovation. And, you know, other reason why we also are very close to the student those days was that, you know, the infrastructure in India itself was very poor, and in Kanpur, like cities, is hard. So there will be power cuts for hours and hours. I still remember that during the thesis submission time, a whole bunch of M.Tech students will come with their, they will take their PCs from the lab and put a little UPS. And we all had this big double car garage in IIT Kanpur. They would put some 3-4 PCs there and type out their thesis. Okay. So, you know, it's a very interesting, okay. We were living like a family, right? The house and the college and the dorm and the lab, they're all kind of seamlessly integrated. So we all used to take maybe for Sunday breakfast, many faculty members will go to the hostel and have aloo bhature, okay, or chola bhature, right, in the hostel. So that is how life was there. And of course, those days we did enjoy the benefit of small classes, which is actually going away because of the relative economics. And, you know, we are having larger and larger classes. And now with this so-called Zoom university, the class sizes are even getting larger. So there are issues. But I think one of the most important thing to me is that, you know, places like IITs particularly, we get exceptionally good students. But remember, exceptionally good students are also not exceptionally good in every subject. There will be exceptionally good in one, may not be in the other. So what we are generally taught is that we should pitch it at the mean level so that, you know, everybody gets something in the course. You know, it is not that, you know, only the toppers get something. Or if you pitch it for the slow learners, then the toppers find it very boring. So I think as a community, as a faculty member, we need to develop an art of teaching to the best as well as to those who may not be the best. But you have to give them an opportunity to give it a try. And this is something which I can also tell you that IIT Kanpur is one of the unique institutes which allowed, you know, I was, as I said, you know, 26-year-old, 27-year-old kids who just come out of a PhD, have no teaching experience, we could innovate. And I think that kind of a provision for experimentation. And, you know, with due respect nowadays, you know, it is important to have things like outcome-based education, but quite often they are now becoming a religion. So, you know, so following the religion or doing the ritual becomes more important than the real spirit. I think we need to kind of stay away from that. Okay. So I just thought that, you know, I will share this with you because I find that something which people remember, there must be some value in it. That's why I thought I will share this with you. So maybe I'll stop for a minute before I go on to the next one. Let me see whether there is anything on the chat.
Sir, usually we wait till the end for the questions.
Oh, okay. Okay. So thank you. Then we will take it at the questions at the end. Okay. Thank you. Then we can go to the next slide. Yeah. So here is okay, another interesting stuff about kind of coming across very unusual students and still be able to kind of get your job done. So I had a PhD student. He happened to be a QIP scholar from an institute. Now it is called NIT. Those days it was called RIT, Regional Institute of Technology, Jamshedpur. Those of you who come from that area, very nice college. And government had a very interesting program called QIP, Quality Improvement Program, where faculty members who are typically from engineering colleges, that's what I am familiar with. I'm sure it is there to other colleges also, that government will pay their salary for about 3-4 years. They can come and do their full PhD with their full salary and be able to kind of get back to the college. This way we could create a large number of faculty members, particularly in the next set of institutions. Okay. So this gentleman happens to be have two interesting stuff. He was my first PhD student and he was 6 years elder to me. Okay, it's very unusual, right? And you know, we were kind of done about 2.5-3 years. It was writing time for writing the thesis. He went to Puttaparthi and met the Sai Baba. And he was an ardent devotee of Baba. And he came back and just was waiting outside my office. So I said, come inside. He came inside, but he was not speaking anything. I found that he was wanting to say something. Then he took out a piece of paper. And I said that, look, I observe Maun Vrat for next 6 months. That is what Baba had told me. So I said, you are a PhD student. I am your PhD guide. How do we kind of manage it? He said, no problem. Whatever I feel, I will write and I will give it to you. And you can speak, I can listen. So you are not constrained one for Maun Vrat. I am only constrained by Maun Vrat. Okay. And lo and behold, we managed to produce a PhD. And the PhD was good quality. And he did something called LAMP, was an acronym for a system, which is actually a precursor to, I think many of you nowadays know something called R, right? So one can actually do great quality work, even with extreme limitations. That is something which I wanted you to kind of carry. And don't compromise on rigor, but do kind of compromise. See, I could have simply said that, look, this is not acceptable to me because you go to Baba and you, the contract is between you and Baba. But you have a contract with me to do a PhD thesis. So they are at conflict. So you decide either you come back after 1 year. But, you know, I still remember that I had a colleague from who also happens to be from Bihar area. So he said that, look, you know, IIT Kanpur is the only place where Pagal Babas like Shadagopan will come. And there will be Pagal Babas choir like his student. And they together can produce a PhD. So. Okay, so it's interesting that, you know, 15 years after teaching, so, you know, as academics, we all attend conferences and most of the conferences are in the United States. So I used to be regularly going. 1995 summer, I had a conference in Chicago area. And one of my students, you know, those of you who are familiar with Naperville is a suburb in Chicago, which is full of Indians, you know, and there was this big AT&T Bell Labs and large number of them were working for the Bell Labs. So what was interesting was that he wanted to spend some quality time with me. And I said that, look, I had taken a couple of days off, but I had to visit a friend in Atlanta. So I thought that, you know, I would visit a friend in Atlanta and get back. So essentially a conference was Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday. I had taken Thursday, Friday, Saturday off. And then, you know, scheduling. So I had only a ticket for Wednesday. So I do have some flexibility. Then he came with this brilliant idea. He said, look, sir, you had studied in US. So he actually happened to be a PhD from IIT Kanpur. He said, look, you see, I always wanted to visit some of the universities, but I don't know many people. So I understand they have great campuses. He has seen a campus of University of Illinois, et cetera. So I thought it may be nice. And the US highway system is so good, you can keep driving for hundreds of miles without getting tired. So, and of course, his car had a nice audio, which those days it was still a tape, right? So we could listen to M.R. Subbulakshmi. So it was nice. So he made a simple proposal that, look, I will become your driver and drive you. That way I will get a quality time uninterrupted. So essentially he said that, look, I want to spend quality time with you. And the best thing is that we drive together. So lo and behold, that is what we did. Okay, I just put a map, so Chicago, Naperville. I kind of drive from Illinois to Indianapolis. And one of the good things about universities in US, a little bit changed in the last few years after the 9/11 and stuff like that. So most things are open most of the time for most people. Okay, so it's kind of fun. You can get in, you can get a feel for it, et cetera, et cetera. So obviously I showed him around Purdue. And also interesting that, you know, I was visiting my friends in Georgia Tech. He could see Georgia Tech. And some interesting learnings, you know, many of you might have heard there is IBM used to have a brand called Lexmark. They used to make printers. Because they got produced in Lexington, Kentucky. That's why they're called Lexmark. They had an IBM plant. And suddenly we discovered that one of our IIT Kanpur alum was working there. We visited the IBM plant in Lexington. And then something which we also did, we actually visited Tennessee Valley Corporation. And many of you who come from Bengal side would know there's something called DVC, Damodar Valley Corporation. Damodar Valley Corporation had actually taken lots of ideas from TVC called Tennessee Valley Corporation. It's a huge hydroelectric plant. So it was fun. And then we did go to Coca-Cola campus in Atlanta, visited, and I learned something at that time. You know, my exact numbers could be off by 1 year, 2 years, etc. So at Olympics wanted some space, and instead of building something, they found something like that. They actually had a deal with the Georgia Tech. They said, we'll take up a few blocks. We'll kind of build them much better than what they are instead of building them afresh. But you give it to us for 2 months. Okay, for 2 months, okay, if your students can find alternate accommodation elsewhere, then they get a much better room. And it's also a good facility permanently. And it was very interesting. So we drove about 2,500 miles, about 800 plus here and there we went. So it was so much fun. Okay, and he said he wanted my quality time. It actually turned out to be the other way. I could get so much of his quality time because he had already spent 10 years in US. He had lots and lots of experience. And then of course, because I had been there earlier, so I had some nice stories to tell. So it was so much fun. So I think we enjoyed every bit of it. And in fact, in March 2020, we had planned for something. Because of COVID, nothing happened. So there was a plan that I will land in New Jersey, drive all the way to San Francisco and fly back. So I have a whole bunch of students all over the United States. We thought that about 14 of them will visit and do it in about 14 to 21 days. And of course, US highway system is so good. Of course, currently even the Indian highway system is really good. So, and this is the best way to explore a country. Okay, so thank you. So remember that to me, learning is all about exploration. Okay, so this is interesting. I moved to IIMB in 1995. I was teaching a course on multimedia. See, multimedia at that time was you know, today what you take it for granted was not easy those days. First of all, most of the PCs were not multimedia ready. We actually had to buy 50 computers from Compaq, which are actually good multimedia machines, because most of the PCs did not have audio and their graphics was terrible. So I was teaching them lots and lots of it. There is a science and technology of multimedia. That is what I taught. That is the first time I realized the difference between IIT students and IIM students. Because IIM students have this heterogeneity. Not all of them are engineering students. Suddenly you find the left brain and the right brain coming together. So there were algorithmic challenges because, you know, one has to convert from file to other and one has to ensure that, after all, when you are doing, you see, you are talking of how to deal with visuals, how to deal with documents, how to deal with audio, how to deal with video. In the process, you are converting all of them into digital. So you all have seen a fax, there's a digital fax of it. You all have seen graphics, there's a digital graphics of it. And digital audio was coming those days, you know, even the PCs did not come with audio. A lot of PCs used to have an external mother daughter card with an Intel processor, all that, right? I'm talking of 1995 kind of a time frame. But I initially was telling my non-engineering students, you may have difficulty because I will have to ask you to write some code and little bit of algorithms, etc. They said, no, sir, we will manage, don't worry. But I actually found this right brain and left brain coming together, they could produce something outstanding. Okay. They actually created travelogues, which are multimedia, which actually became websites 10 years later, you know, because that is the, because exceptionally bright kids, you know, you all know the IIM kids, right? But when you actually had the engineering and the non-engineering students together, the kind of stuff they could do was amazing. And they actually produced one of the nice early version of Bhagavad Gita CD, which is multimedia, and another version of that. I actually had the privilege of formally releasing it from ISKCON. And Kirloskar Multimedia as a company started. Of course, the company has not been doing well, but remember, an automotive company like Kirloskar, see, nowadays you think only these days, you know, startups are going crazy and, you know, somebody is in retail, suddenly starts fintech, etc. Those things were there even at that time. It is just not that they were not in large numbers and they were not being talked about so much. Okay, Kirloskar's, you all know, as an oil engine company, they created a company called Multimedia. Okay, so I taught a course on e-commerce, previous one. And remember, I'm talking of 1998. So we're really talking of not even Treta Yuga, Krita Yuga, right? Krita, Treta, Dwapara, Kali, right? We are really talking of ancient age, right? 1998. And the only fellow who was actually using the term e-commerce was Amazon, which is also a bookstore. Okay, at that time, it was nothing more than a bookstore. The only thing was Amazon would say that, you know, we have, our catalog is much larger than anyone else can. And then there were lots of critics. They said, look, you know, this fellow is cheating and all that. His catalog has one, but there were New York Times articles. You can go and read people writing that, you know, Amazon has only 200 books. Any other book, he actually goes to somebody, buys it and gives it to you. And he was making money out of shipping cost. See, those days, you know, you have to pay for it. People are willing to pay for shipping, pay premium, just because they were able to order books, particularly if you are not in metros. Okay, so that was how a bookstore came. But I think we should give credit to Jeff Bezos. He always had this much larger vision. He thought that one day he will not only be selling, he was very clear, he was just not selling books. He was recreating the entire purchase stuff, and he would be into many other stuff. And I still remember there were a couple of small number of people with whom he used to interact. One of them happens to be my former student. And you all know that the e-commerce or the regular commerce also, particularly the business school students would know, the largest number of the largest sale amount happens in the United States in what is called the Black Thursday or Black Friday, Black Saturday. So Thanksgiving is always on a Thursday in November, I think 3rd or something like that. And then Thursday, Friday, Saturday, Sunday is a long weekend. That is the time, because it is sufficiently before Christmas and the purchase season starts, a lot of purchases happen. So people thought that, so the IT systems used to get too much in demand. The demand on the IT system was higher, so they were provisioning, they were buying more and more. And Jeff Bezos used to argue that, look, you guys need this only for the Thanksgiving and the Christmas. Rest of the time, you can't do anything else. Can you not find some use for it? That is how Amazon Cloud Services came. Okay, so bookstore to Big B called e-commerce, then to Amazon Works, Amazon Cloud, okay? And of course, day before yesterday, I was actually watching around the same time. Okay, Jeff Bezos actually takes an 82-year-old lady and an 18-year-old boy along with his brother, go up to the sky and come back safely, right? Blue Origin, okay? So I think it is kind of interesting, okay? And we actually talked about digital money in that course. We talked about payment systems in that course. You know, we had to wait for about 15 years before UPI could come, before crypto could come. And so two things which I wanted you to know. So in the year 1999, the largest customer in India for Amazon happens to be a tiny institute called the IIIT Bangalore. Because there are very few people who knew, very few people who believed in it. And I had an international credit card. So I all my purchases for the library, I was just ordering through Amazon. Okay. So, but a lot of people in India do not know. There was a famous e-commerce store started right in Bangalore called FabMart. And one Vaidhi started it. He was ahead of time. He did not go well. But it's interesting. And something, you know, particularly for the ladies, it is interesting. There were 106 Mangal Sutras were ordered on FabMart. Very unusual, right? So the parent in America, the child in India, the child in America, the parent, et cetera, et cetera. But they still wanted to go and buy on a particular day in at least southern part of India. People buy Mangal Sutra only on Fridays, only from these shops. So they could do that. So it is interesting. The consumer behavior in e-commerce is very, very different from what the consumer behavior you normally study in the B-school textbooks. So I think that is getting really. So again, this is partly motivated due to two reasons. When the institute started, we actually had to operate from a temporary premise. The only premise that was made available thanks to the government of Karnataka was one floor, half a floor of a tower in ITPL in Whitefield. And these are all built for office complexes, basically built for software factories. And they had lots of pillars. So what happened was that we couldn't have a large enough classroom. Government and industry together created IIIT. One of the key things which they're very clear was they wanted large numbers. They said, look, we can't wait for 10 years for you to produce 200 people at the rate of 20. We want 150 students per year. So we, in about 3-4 years, we want to have 500 students graduate out of you. So they said, look, whatever it costs, we will take care, but you have to do it. So I walk into the building, and you know, I'm sure all of you as teachers, you realize, if you can't maintain eye contact with the student, so you have lost the game, right? You can't really put a longish room and then make them teach because I can't see. I don't get my feedback, right? So I said that, look, with this one, I can't build classrooms which are beyond something like 60, 70. So what do I do? So here comes some interesting. One of my colleagues came with a brilliant idea, happened to be an electronics engineer. We together kind of rigged something. So what we did was there was one main classroom, which was a little bigger, so it is about 75 capacity. And we created two classrooms, each of 40 capacity, 75 plus 40, 155. And then we put a large, those days, you know, they're very expensive, but nonetheless, we went for a 100-inch television. And then we put some basic electronics. So what happens is, I will be, the instructor will be delivering to the main classroom. Both the other classrooms will actually see the instructor on a large 100-inch TV. And whenever they want to ask questions, they will actually kind of use a remote. And then there will be a marker, which will say question mark on the main screen. The instructor would know And it will also say 103 was the main classroom. 104 and 105 are the sister classrooms. 2 and 104. And it will say question mark 102, question mark 104. And the instructor will say 102, ask your question, please. And then the camera will capture the student and then show it on all the three screens. And the student will ask the question and then the answer will be relayed to everybody. Okay. This was purely a need, which was basically tinkering. Okay. And this is precisely what, in fact, again, some of the alumni, when they were giving a farewell, they actually were reminiscing and they said, sir, we had Zoom University 20 years back. So it happens, right? I think necessity is the mother of invention. And another unusual thing, one student had a scooter accident and he had to be in bandage for 4 weeks. And he said, sir, I need a semester drop. That is the time when some brilliant student came with the idea. He said, sir, I used to actually go from the institute to my home, which is some few kilometers away. And his father used to be working in NAL. His house was on the way. So what he used to do was simply using VHS tape, all the day's classes will be recorded in the tape. And then on the way back, I will drop it off to the student's house. And then he would actually watch it. He did not have a tape TV. So we bought a special TV for him. So put it there. And of course, the parents were really appreciative that the institute walks this extra length to even buy a TV and deliver it every day. The director himself delivering the tape every day. So it just worked out well because the student is doing exceedingly well in GE. But the kind of connects he has with me, he has with the university is amazing, okay? And later, next year, we extended this to Mindtree. Mindtree wanted to, Professor PCP Bhatt used to be teaching. He was a former professor in IIT Delhi. One of the founders of Mindtree happens to be his student and he wanted all his classmates to get the benefit. So we were just to kind of delivering it every day. And something very interesting we did, you know, little later, maybe 2002 kind of a time frame, that is the time when open courseware had come. Lot of video cassettes and lots of tapes and CDs and online were available. But what our students found, this is very interesting, again, a student's mind. An hour-long lecture on a video is very boring, right? And quite often they find you don't need all the 1 hour. So what they did was they took some 20 cassettes or 20 courses, and for each course, they made a kunji. They made an index, okay? They said, look, if you have difficulty in this part, go to minute number 7 to 10. And he says, this professor is brilliant, nowhere else you will get it. Watch for sure 13 to 17 minutes, okay? And then they will say that, look, you know, 1 to 4, 9 to 11, some minutes, you can actually easily kind of fast forward. You don't lose anything. Okay. And, you know, out of this, about 2 years back or 4 years back, a company came out as a startup, it's doing very well, called VideoKen. It automatically indexes the content of a video. Just as you have a book, you create an index, you give a video, it will make an index. Okay. So things like that happening. But I think what is important is empathy with the student makes a huge difference. And technology will come around to serve us as long as we are clear about what we need. These are very interesting things. I think it is also interesting. You know, the background of the students are also interesting. See, I think what is nice about premier institutes is we get students from all over. I think one of the nice things, I keep talking to my good friend called God. Okay, God is very kind, right? He does not necessarily make only intelligent people only be available from rich kids, right? There are lots and lots of poor students who are extremely bright. They generally don't have opportunities, but if we give them an opportunity, they will come up with amazing stuff. So we do get a lot of these. So it is important that nowadays I use the term called finally Indians are solving India's problems. You know, I always tell that my generation, Nilesh, you and I, we all went to United States in 70s and 80s. And we were serving multinational corporations, international universities, which are all busy solving the world's problems. Nice thing to do. We're also joined the workforce of solving the world's problem. And then come 90s, the last 20 years, the IT industry created something slightly different. You are still solving the world's problem, but working from Bangalore, Hyderabad, Bhopal, Indore through something called outsourcing. So Indians working for multinational corporations, solving world's problem. Indian working for multinational corporations, Indian corporations sitting in India, sitting elsewhere, solving world's problem. But finally, Indians are solving India's problem. I'll give you an example. I'm sure, you know, 11,000 pairs of trains run every day. Okay, thanks to COVID, many of them are not running, but hopefully they will start, right? So many people travel long distance on the train. And, you know, a lot of times you have to get down. You know, we all used to go to Kanpur by a train from Chennai and get down at a place called Jhansi. Invariably, it will be 1:30, 2:30, around that time, early morning, take another train. So chances are that you will sleep off, right? So we'll tell the TT, sometimes the TT forgets, et cetera, et cetera. So these fellows start up a very simple, it's called Suruk. So all that you have is, you have a small little app, you put it in, okay. It was actually something which works even in feature phones, you know, it was a very interesting app they did, okay, even Nokia phones. You don't need an iPhone, okay? So it's very simple functionality. So what it will do is, because you have to keep the GPS on, if you keep the GPS on, see, remember there is something called schedule. Trains don't necessarily run on schedule. Sometimes they can be ahead, sometimes they can be behind, etc. Announcements happen, announcements don't happen. You know, most of the Indian trains don't have announcement, right? But GPS is, okay, if you are getting in at Chennai and going to sleep, and you said that I have to be kind of woken up 15 minutes before Jhansi, approximately the train speed is 60 kilometers or 80 kilometers. You make a calculation and you can actually say 15 minutes before. All that you need is you will get a beep beep, you get an SMS, you get a sound, etc., etc. Okay. It's a very simple service. Okay. So it actually serves the needs of the people, because all that you can do is you can comfortably go to sleep, because you are traveling alone. Somebody will, you will actually woken up so that you don't miss the connecting train. Okay. Simple. You know, several versions of it still exist today, but it is important for you. This, I think I'm only giving the basic ideas. The second one was they created an IDO phone. You know, many of you in Bhopal or Bangalore or Delhi, you have this problem, right? You are new to the town, you get into the auto rickshaw fellow. The auto rickshaw fellow either overcharges. Okay. So all that you do is, as soon as you get into the auto rickshaw, you invoke that app, you give the destination, knowing the GPS, it will show you the route, it will also tell you what is the approximate time and cost. Okay, very simple service. But it was so useful. So obviously these companies don't make it into a unicorn. They don't make $1 billion. But interestingly, they serve a purpose. And they serve a purpose for a significantly large number of populations, okay? And of course, you know, some forms of other, now I think the Ubers of the world are actually using some form of it. The next slide, okay? So this is something, I'm sure Professor Shastri, does the Ola Uber there in Bhopal also? Some version of it?
Yes.
Okay. So everyone knows Uber, and you know, generally what all the Economic Times fellows will write is we have something called Ola, which is a copy of Uber. Okay. Partly what they say is true, but actually part what they say is not true. Because if you actually go that way, you can say every software company is a copy of IBM. Right. But I think there is a company called Taxi for sure, which is now subsumed under Ola. They did something on the interface, which is very different, which today even Uber uses it, okay? So I think going back to my Indian solving India's problems, so what happens is something like this, right? You know, anywhere else, you have one way of using the taxi, but in India, typically what happens is the use case, in fact, the founder of the taxi for sure is a person who actually told me this own use case. So, you know, you are a typical 20s, 30s person, software professional. Your father or mother has some chronic disease. So once in a month or once in a week or once in 2 months, he or she has to be taken to a doctor. Normally, what you would have done, you would have taken a days off, go home, take the dad or mom to the doctor, spend quality time with him, bring him back. But the mom or dad also feel sometimes they are a bother for you. So they would not you want you to waste one day of leave. And you also sometimes may not be in a position to take leave. Here is an interesting stuff. When Uber came, etc., all that you do is when you open the app, it will actually show a point where the different taxis are there. But taxi for sure changed that interface. It will show the type of the car, icon of which car, whether it is Maruti or Mahindra or Hyundai or Honda, whatever. Much more interesting, it will show you the face of the driver who is driving it. So when you book a car, you actually know what type of a car, what is the car number, and the driver. And I go to office. Now, going back to my use case, my father or mother is at home. I go to work. Maybe the appointment is at 12 o'clock. So 11 o'clock, I book a taxi to be reaching at home. And I also send an SMS privately to my father or mother, giving the car type, car number, and the face of the driver. So when their car goes and reports, they get an SMS. They come down and then get into the car. At that time, they can check it is the same person. Because you have the comfort, this is what my son or daughter had recommended, so it is safe, so I get in. So I go to the doctor, finish the whole thing, another taxi gets booked, the same thing happens, I go home. And most important stuff, he does not have to worry about paying the taxi because the payment happens from my account. Okay, this is typical Indian, right? I think it is baked into today, but this was not possible. Uber would not have thought about it. I can also tell you, initial days, Uber even was discussing, are we getting into the privacy rights of the taking a picture of the driver and putting it? Okay. So those things are important. I'm not saying, but I think a lot of times, as long as you understand the purpose, you see, you need to build trust. Otherwise, how do you make people use the system? Okay. So maybe I will kind of quickly stop or take the last one and stop. Yes. Go to the next one. Okay, this is something, you know, this is again by our alum. It's called Plugo. So what you have is a power bank on the go. Okay, so it started about 4 years back. So what it offers is, it's a power bank. You see, all of us, we travel and, you know, battery is never sufficient. And as that happens, you know, particularly for sales folks, when they go and make a presentation, that too in a public sector, because the meetings get longer and longer. So generally you have 2 hours, 2.5 hours. Then, you know, so then you keep scurrying around for a power bank. So what these people said was they made some very interesting, they made nice power banks, actually were nicely made. They also made some special stand. The stand is an IoT. The stand is an IoT, the individual units are also IoT. So if you are a customer, so what you can do is you take your phone and then press the QR code. Okay, once the QR code matches, it will pop up a power bank. Okay, then it immediately says that, look, you have taken this power bank, you will be charged so much for 1 day, 2 days. Okay, and it was available in about 16 airports. They were planning to extend it to railway stations. So before that, I think COVID came. But and then whenever you are through, you return, you can go back to one of the places. You can take it from any city and return it to any city. And if you have taken it for 1 day and paid only for 1 day, after 1 day, it will stop operating. So again, the power of IoT, right? Smart things, okay. In one sense, it's not a big deal. But in other sense, it solves Indian problem. And what is interesting is that because they have some, I think they had 45,000 such units and about 10,000 customers, etc. The information which they have collected, who checked in, how much they used, etc., that is useful. So Ola Electric is actually planning to repurpose it for the analytics and the AI. Okay, so this company is pivoting into EV charging, electric vehicle charging. Okay, so let me, okay, so sorry for this kind of going all over. What I want to get across is, see, these are not lectures, these are all what is called sambhashana, right? But basically kind of having some interaction of our experiences, etc. And to me, I think teaching is the gift of being a lifelong learner. Okay, I think every opportunity provides you, and so many of the alumni, each one of them bringing their own perspective, and this is truly from the my heart to bottom of my heart. Blessed Indies is our profession. Okay, and thank you. And any question? And thanks for the patience. Thank you. I hope it made some sense to some people somewhere. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. I think it's lovely stories. As you said, the 10 stories talking about observation, empathy, and the competence that come together to recognize the challenges that other people face, empathize with them, and then be able to solve the challenges that they face. So it's an amazing story of several innovations. Now we have the questions coming up. It's my pleasure to read those questions for you.
Sure.
So the first question we have from Raj Sen, and the question is, meeting sir, as you mentioned, learning is exploring. Can you suggest a few effective methods of teaching and learning which can inculcate the exploration quality in our students, which can help them to become futuristic?
I would emphatically say yes. Okay, I think this is something we all should encourage as much as possible. So encourage exploration. And I actually feel that, in the age of internet, when you have access to more information and people still don't explore. No, even in the Google, how many of us explore beyond the first screen, right? And I think probably if we can also emphasize in our own way to our own students that we value such encouragement. I think finding some unusual answer is something which we value than finding what I call the most appropriate answer. Okay, I think we need to kind of, as someone said, we need to create more and more of problem finder than problem solvers. Because to me, what is interesting about these things is when Indians solving India's problem, what I really appreciate is they're actually finding out problems. These are the problems which people face. Thousands and thousands of people or 100 are traveling, out of which dozens of people are missing a train every day simply because they overslept. Okay. So this is solving a small number of people's problem, but nonetheless, it is a problem. And in the process, they did it and it is repurposed for some completely different stuff. Thank you.
Greetings, sir. Kindly present some of your opinion in regards to building trust with the students in respect to the present generation of students.
Okay, that's an excellent question. Okay, to some extent, I would say, Professor Shastri, myself, and our age group, we are kind of a little lucky. Because what happened was that, other day I was asked in one of the college, somebody asked me a question, sir, what is the difference between teaching in an IIT, IIIT, and teaching in a tier 3 engineering college? I said, look, hats off to you guys. You guys are doing something remarkable, I told them. Because when you walk into your class in a typical IIT, at least in our time, you are accepted by the student as competent. You don't have to prove that you are competent. Okay, so it was easy for them to kind of empathize on both sides, so that knowledge transfer can happen. But in a typical tier 3 institutions, particularly in rural parts of India, et cetera, so the student don't even accept the teacher as a knowledgeable person. So half the time you have to fight this proving, et cetera. So that is one reason why the trust gets broken, okay? But what I have found, because this is something where I think each person has to discover, I think, the other occasion somebody asked me, what is that you enjoy most in teaching in IITs? I said, look, this is something which people don't necessarily share, but it is true. Teaching is a performing art. Every day is a performing art, just as a performing art. You can't say that, look, I performed yesterday so I can be relaxed. No, you have to have the same seriousness. My wife used to make fun of me. He said, look, after 40 years of teaching, you still need 10 minutes. See, 10 minutes before a talk, even today, 4 o'clock onwards, I'll close my eyes. I just need to compose my thoughts, right? So coming back, so what happened is that you actually have to kind of go well prepared. And a typical IIT kind of a class, when you have bright students, they will ask uncomfortable questions. Many of them, you don't have the answer. So I actually used to explain the position of a typical professor at the end of the class is a person with wounds all over, walking back. But there is still some self-respect left in us. So we lick our wounds, think through, go to the library those days, now go to the internet, scratch our heads, find an answer. Next day, we go back with an answer. And I'm just using an interesting expression, which, okay, because I'm in Kanpur, so you will understand, you know. So you could see two things. One is the student, after listening, will be telling his student, Saleh ko kuch aata hai. To me, at the end of the his eyes or her eyes, there is a tinge of gratitude. I think we live for that. Right? So I think that is precisely what it is. Encourage them to ask questions. Don't stop them from asking questions. And be honest. And there are times when you don't have an answer. You tell them you don't have an answer. I think that is how institutions are made. That is what makes the teacher-student bonding, right? So I think I think the moment they find out that you are honest and you are sincere, I think they start empathizing, okay? Of course, there is one new dimension which has come these days. It is called the problem of WhatsApp Zoom University confusing people. All that I can say is that compared to what the doctors are feeling, we seem to be having less of it. In fact, my doctor friends tell me that every patient knows about every disease before they come to them, because they all have discovered so much of things written up. Okay. So, but that is part of the challenge. But my core stuff is, I think you get over this very fast. You know? So I think the sincerity of purpose is something which is self-revealing. It is like Surya's Prakasha, right? So people get it real fast. Sorry for that long answer to your short question.
Sir, I have a second question, which is very timely questions in terms of the situation that we're facing. The question says, how do you mentor and teach effectively in the current situation of online teaching?
It's very interesting. Online teaching, sometimes I think, you know, there are lots of problems of online teaching, but look at also some of the strengths with online teaching. We actually did some little research, you know, so it's very research in a very applied sense, you know, it's not very, okay. But nonetheless, we did collect some data and all. You see, typical classroom of 60 minutes to 90 minutes, you will probably find we take about 3 to 6 questions. Okay. And actually you find beyond that, there are no questions. And probably, you know, I think students also get tired and they kind of walk out, right? But in a typical online, if you do for 1 hour to 90 minutes, the average number of questions which you get is about 12 to 15. Multiple reasons. One is that when you're asking questions with everybody around, you also have the feeling that, you know, particularly students who are not necessarily the top of the class, so will it be a stupid question? You know, will I reveal myself to be not understanding anything by asking this question? There is a little embarrassment value, etc. So what happened? Half the question die there. But in online medium, so there is anonymity is assured, right? You don't have to answer this question when everybody has to know. You can send it by email, you can send it by chat, etc. Because of that, we are getting more questions. So what we do is that online sessions, we always have more time to answer the questions. So next time when you go there, start answering this question, either you use the class itself or use online channel, other channels, but answer more questions. The second thing is there are lots of tools. I think, you know, don't try to become expert yourself. You know, I think this is where you should take advantage of younger students. There are lots and lots of little tools which are available. You can do a little poll. You can do a quick survey. You can ask them some questions, etc. See, what happens is if you run a 90-minute class by one-way talking, okay, it is nearly impossible to kind of keep the interest of the class. So you have to break it into smaller stuff. And I find that using some of the surveys, questions, feedback, throw some questions, et cetera, et cetera. Sometimes there are even some games available. And the kids find out more and more interesting stuff much faster than any one of us. So best thing is use the students, okay, and do that. That is my take. Thank you.
So the next question relates to the innovation, and then you had several examples of that in your talk. Dr. Shekhar Upadhyay is asking, how we can encourage the ingenuity in the students?
Okay. So I think first and foremost is that I think as a university, I think you have to somehow get the message that the innovations, ingenuity are welcome. Okay. A lot of times they are tolerated, but I think you have to make them welcome. Okay. And sometimes you would even amplify, you would also kind of share it with others. You will celebrate them. Second thing is that I think one of the good things I like about the current generation is they are not as conformist as what we used to be in our generation. Okay. So I think encourage non-conformists. Okay. They don't have to conform. Okay. Because, you know, I think differing is something which is perfectly fine. So they should. At the same time, overall, what we call we agree to disagree kind of stuff. So that is the second. Third thing is that, you see, a lot of times, you know, even among the students, whenever I ask them to give an example of innovation, they will think of an iPhone. I keep telling them that, you know, iPhone is a great example. My good friend Steve is an amazing guy, et cetera, et cetera. But those things are once in a billion, once in a million. See, even in Apple, right? They could come up with an iPhone, right? Now, 2007 was the iPhone, right? They still keep producing the same phone 14 years later, right? After some time, it is not possible. So you don't have to think of breakthrough innovation only. Lots and lots of incremental innovations, which is right around you in the campus, in the dormitory. You know, like I'll give you an example. One day, I think our faculty members were actually in tears of joy. You know, I just went there and slowly I also moved into the tears of joy. Simple reason is our students somehow decided that on the Deepavali day, you know, we have about 40 people who serve food, right? Who cook, you know, we have a kitchen. And most of the time, you know, people self-serve itself, but at the same time, you know, they have to clean the plates. There's a machine that cleans, but still afterward, they have to wipe it, put it back. They have to bring the bartan, the big bagonas, et cetera, et cetera. So there are about 30, 40 people. So what they said was that these are the people who are feeding us all through the year. One day, let us feed. They made all the 40 of them sit and the students were serving them. Okay. So what happens is the empathy that you develop there ensure that the quality of food. So it, see what happens is now people are not cooking just for a living, right? They are cooking because they find that they are cooking to an audience which seem to empathize with them. They try to learn from them. They know they will sit together and they actually found out on January 26th, they actually go and find out where their children are. Do they go to school? Do they need some help, et cetera, et cetera. So you no longer look at them as a maid servants, okay? You look at them as somebody who is providing wholesome food for you, okay? So the reason why I'm saying is a lot of these small things we don't necessarily amplify and encourage. Big things are, okay, but then of course, you know, like another person did some interesting, you know, we got a robotic arm to do something interesting. Once again, not a great deal, but nonetheless, it was something which was, that actually brought him to one of the big competitions and won a prize in Tokyo. So what happens is that once you start encouraging them, they do more and more and more. That is where they keep going up. So that would be my take.
Thank you, sir. I think a very clear message that we need to encourage even incremental innovations and then practice people when they show up some, you know, innovative ideas. As you said, that usually it's tolerated. We need to encourage and amplify it. I think that's the key message here. Now we have next question that says, this is from Anshu Pathak. He says, thank you so much, sir, for the enriching session. What type of the changes in learning methods do you think will continue after the pandemic is over? I think we all are mulling over what's going to go back and what's here to stay.
I don't know, honestly. Okay. So this is something which we have to wait and see.
I think you just gave an example of what we should do in the classroom when we don't know the answer.
Okay. So give it back to the students. They will find an answer.
Thank you.
You see, Nikhil, that, okay, if you get a chance, go and read. There is a nice paper in the Higher Education Chronicle, mm-hmm. which says the future of education is definitely not online. And from one of the very distinguished professors, because what happens is there is a lot of talk going on that, you know, if you can do all these things in Zoom University, and if I'm sure some regulators will say that, look, if you can record, you can maintain a record of all the classes, and if they finish the exams, they can be given degree certificates, and our gross enrollment ratio can multiply dramatically. So we don't need universities, we need only one Zoom University. So these kind of thoughts are also going on, which to me are, to say the least, dangerous. Because even in Upanishad time, there was a clear mention that 20% is what you learn in a classroom. 20% is what you learn when you are applying it through the exercises. 20% is what you learn from your classmates, you know, when you discuss with them. Same question, people look at it differently. I think that is what, so many answers to the same question. And then 20 minutes, what we call as capstone kind of a project. You kind of integrate across the courses, integrate across what you learned in first year and second year and third year, across humanities and technology. And the last 20% is what you learn in life. So the classroom is only 20%. So Zoom University only addresses the 20%, right? We still have 80% left. So I think it is important for us to be clear. Yes, there are some efficiencies, and particularly during COVID, you know, it was not a complete washout. Otherwise, it would have been disaster. Without Zoom University, without internet, I think so many people would have had so much difficulty. That is fine, but let it not be viewed as a substitute. Okay, I think education is a human process. There is so much to. I'm not saying necessarily you have to go back to exactly what we are doing. Okay, so it could be a good mix of online and offline. I don't even like the word offline. I like the word face-to-face. Online and face-to-face, it's a good mix of it. And maybe some of this, even these basic questions, we may actually have to revisit. You know, we have the concept of a credit, okay? So the credit is kind of baked into the system again. A typical 3-credit course at the undergraduate or the graduate level, post high school level, will be 3 credits, will equal into 45 contact hours delivered over 15 weeks, right? This is baked in. But should we break out of that? Is a question. So question is, can some students do the 4 years in 2 years? Can some student do the 4 years in 6 years without really affecting the quality? And so some of these questions need to be addressed. And second thing is that too much of fixation about numbers, you know, UGC going and saying that, you know, they always think in terms of class size of 60. Okay. See, going back to what I said, your ability to kind of track every student eyeballs are important, but you don't have to make it 60 or 40, 20, etc. So I think a lot of those numbers under which we are assuming, you know, even the faculty student ratio, 1:10, 1:15. Okay. Do they always make sense in all the schools and all the time? Okay. Maybe it varies from year to year, right? Okay. So you need interaction, but at the same time, what is the level of interaction? I think many of these things will need to be questioned. And good thing is NEP has thrown lots of questions, but I think we need to discover lots of answers. There are not answers are not there in the policy. So it is something which we have to rediscover, and each one of us have to discover for ourselves. So what applies to JLU will not apply to JNU, right? Thank you.
Thank you.
Shastri is smiling, I'm sure for right reason.
I like the change of the middle word in the two universities.
and you see, at least by English language, you are ahead.
So we have another question here, which is actually related to the story that you talked about. Dr. Ram Yadav, who's recently PhD faculty that we have here, he is wondering aloud that if the Manvrata student that you had interaction with, if that Manvrat actually helped you to be far more productive and more efficient than what you would have been otherwise.
I think yes. He did allow him to stay more focused. Okay. But I think, you see, this is a call, right? You see, you get an opportunity and not everyone uses the opportunity the right way or use the opportunity itself. Okay. So it did help.
So I think in the interest, so I think we have time. Can we go up till about 6 o'clock? That's as decided.
Okay, from my side, it is okay, but I feel, you know, that, okay, first and foremost, okay, just to do a simple show of hands,
yeah.
Okay, be absolutely brutal. You have to tell me honestly, okay, was this 40 minutes, 45 minutes worth it? If it is yes, show this way, otherwise show it this way. Oh boy, quite a few hands going up. Okay, so I am feel happy. No, but you know, it's, oh, I think it is very nice. That was innovation. Somebody doing this.
Yeah.
Thank you. No, it's important because you see, Professor Shastri, you must be having some thoughts when you ask me to talk. And I instantaneously kind of responded that this is how I'm going to do. And you were kind enough to instantaneously say yes. So, you know, I myself was thinking that, you know, it is not about science, technology, education, policy. You know, this is what people are expected to talk about. So I thought that, you know, I'm just going to tell some stories and, you know, people will, they feel that, look, you completely wasted our time, the two end of the day, et cetera. So as long as I have not wasted your time, I am
Sir
happy.
Sir, when you thought of your name, I had to think of 10 people with my colleagues as to who should the 10 be. And okay. Even as I exhausted the first 5 fingers of my first hand, your name was already there.
Thank you.
The reason is this one, we wanted to make it interdisciplinary.
Yes.
And I often find that engineering, very senior people in engineering can talk about engineering very well. But when you ask them to make a generic lecture to people who are non-engineers, sometimes they face a challenge. And I knew that that would not be a challenge for you at all. Secondly, I realized that with all your years of experience, if you could just be anecdotal as you were today, that itself would be a great learning for all my colleagues. And thirdly, you have been an institution builder, and from all the examples you took, it's very clear that you have been a mentor to people. So I thought at least 70, 75 people more should hear that, and maybe some of them would get inspired by that.
Thank you. And I tell you, okay, so you see, this is what is called self-inviting. I have been kind of telling Professor Shastri that, look, whenever I get a chance, I'm going to visit you. Okay, so be ready. One day I will come and have a cup of coffee with you very soon. Because one, I like Bhopal. Second thing is, you know, as I said, the name itself is very interesting. And of course, Professor Shastri is there, and you are all there now that I have, instead of one friend, I have 50 friends or 100 friends today to look up. Okay, so I do have lots of other friends in Bhopal also to look up. So it will be nice. And I think it is a great experiment in the making. And I think your campus video, which I saw on the web, is very inviting. And you have a pyramid building, right?
That's a library building, sir.
Ah, so it's so nice. And
Nileshi, any
okay,
final
so I, before I closing, I think I should share something with you because
sure,
it is
sir,
important.
Sir.
Okay, just take 1 minute, sir.
Sure, sir.
You know, University of California, you all familiar, you know, Berkeley, San Diego, Los Angeles, etc. They have 10 campuses. So this is one of the large public system in the United States. And then they created a new member of that system in a town called Merced, M-E-R-C-E-D. You can go and explore Merced, UC Merced. And then the president of that university happened to be a physicist. She was chosen. She was given $1 billion to create that. And she was going around the world trying to kind of learn from new universities and turn something, etc. Lo and behold, she kind of landed in my office, okay? So I was pleasantly surprised that, you know, it was not even a 100 crore kind of institute, and she's billion-dollar enterprise she's building. What is that I have to offer? She said, no, I think I have looked at something. We had some discussion. She invited me. I went and visited her, gave a talk, et cetera, et cetera. But one thing which I learned from her, you know, she said, Sharagopan, you people don't realize how lucky you are. And she said that in the United States, a major public university with a large campus and large investment like UC Mercer has not been done in 40 years. Right? See, then you look at it, all the universities which you talk about have been around for ages, right? So they have really not added, you know, Olin College here, you know, they're all very small to private institutions, a large public institution. Okay. And so what happens is we in India, we are lucky that you are all creating a new university. And remember, universities are the longest surviving entities in the planet. Corporations generally don't serve for 25 years, some serve a century. I think the total number of corporations which have survived 500 are one or two. Saying Gobain is the only thing which people talk of, right? Whereas you have, at least we'll talk of dozen universities which have survived 500 years. You know, everyone knows Cambridge and Oxford and a whole bunch of them in Europe, etc. Our own Nalanda in some sense, blah, okay? So what happens is Jagaran, JLU is going to be living for centuries. And where do you get a chance to be part of the founding team of an organization that is going to live centuries, okay? So count your blessings, you know, that is something which rarely you get. And India is the only country where you get. So China, you get in a slightly different one. Chinese government decided to set up some 20 universities, all central planning. But here, you know, see, you know, JLU can be so different from JNU and you can still compete. I think that is the beauty of the situation. So I think you are lucky to be part of a new university, which is in the making right before your eyes. And that is going to be there for your daughter to granddaughter to grand-grand-grand-granddaughter to see.
Could you please suggest top three competencies in a mentor or teacher, which should always be there, and the top three that should not be there?
Okay. See, the first and foremost is still what I call empathy. See, to use a typical engineering sense, you know, in engineering, we use the term called impedance mismatch. So electricity can flow only when there is a right voltage, right? So what happens is the impedance mismatch is there. And a lot of time the impedance mismatch happens because of lack of empathy. And remember, no two individuals in the planet are the same. As they say, if they are same, the God would not have created one. So God is extremely good at creation, right? So because of that, every student is different. Every faculty member is different. Both the students. So first and foremost is this empathy. The second thing is, this is what I personally feel, giving the student the freedom. See, a lot of times we try to make our PhD student a carbon copy of ourselves, which is not the best thing, okay? So can we give them the freedom? Third, I think it is important for them to know that they should hear the word no as many as yes from you. Lots of things we do not know. I think that is the beauty. I think you don't have to know everything in the world, right? You could be the competent person. So, because life is much, much bigger, okay? So the three things which possibly we should not have, I think to some extent, a lot of things which we, you know, in the country, we have a tradition. This tradition has a lot of good things and the tradition also has lots of not so good things. As I said earlier, you know, Vyasa Gaddi is a notion, right? That means there's a pita on which somebody is sitting, historically called Vyasa. So the moment you think you are a teacher, you think you have the right to boss over students, boss over others, you know. And second thing is your value or your views are actually more important or more correct than the student. Okay. So I think holier than thou attitude is the one which you should not have for sure. The second thing is that we also tend to become condescending. This is again related to the first one. Okay. So condescending attitude comes very naturally. Third, I think, okay, here I will differ from many, many people that what is most important is you find your own niche. I'll give you an example then, you know. See, you all know there's an institute called Rochester Institute of Technology. You know, it's in the east coast of India. Okay, Eastman Kodak Company is there in the town called Rochester. So he was visiting India. And as usual, Times of India persons, you know, typical question they ask, sir, when will you become an MIT? And then without flickering an eye, the person said, never. Then he said, why should I become an MIT? So it is true the MIT rank is much higher than RIT, but RIT does not want to become an MIT. RIT wants to be an RIT. Right? So I think what happens is that a lot of times we want to be somebody. We want to be something. I want this to be there. My feeling is, I think be yourself. Okay, both to the faculty and to the student, just be yourself. And you create your own surroundings, you create your own. I think there is in the God's creation, there's a place for everyone. You don't have to become someone. You don't have to imitate someone. You don't have to copy someone. You don't have to prove that you are better than someone. Okay, I think a lot of time we waste more time thinking about others than ourselves. Okay, if we can avoid that, and there's a trap to which academics get into easily because all the time we are surrounded by the same, right? See, at least in corporate, you know, people travel all around, so they're meeting customer today, somebody else, etc. But, you know, to some extent, faculty, we also become a coterie sometimes, right? We keep talking to the same set of people. So I think kind of break. Last thing I would tell you is, you know, we tried that in IIT Kanpur in the early days. IIT Kanpur had one faculty building where all the faculty members were sitting. So I still remember as an engineering student, first time I actually saw what is the typical title of a chemistry thesis. Great education for us. So what I'm saying is every faculty member in JLU should have walked into every other department at least once or twice a year. Just to go and sit in that PhD work, go and sit in their classes. This is something which we encourage a little bit in IIITB. You know, faculty members go, take permission, tell your colleague and go and sit in other classes. Other thing we try to do is we co-teach courses. So, you know, ideally I have been telling that no course should be taught alone. You know, every course must be taught by at least two people, three people. So what happens is, and when you are sitting in others' class, you actually learn. And not only that, you also contribute. Other person is also learning. So I think then what happens is you kind of always concentrate on what value I bring without worrying what the other person will think.